I'd like to start today by elaborating this concept of irreducible invariant subspaces that I've talked about quite a bit, and put it in a general context and to show you how it's related to subspaces of operators and ultimately the Vigner-Eckhart theorem, which is one of the main goals of these recent presentations. So to begin with, let's be rather general about the space in question. Let's call the vector space D just to get a general notation for it. In fact, we've talked about two different kinds of vector spaces so far upon which rotations act, and this is part of the summary here from last lecture. One of them is spaces of Ketz. We found if we rotate the basis vectors, we have linear combinations of those basis vectors with D matrices as coefficients. And also, ordinary three-dimensional space, if you use a spherical basis, you rotate both basis vectors, you get the same kind of linear combination, showing that the spherical basis is actually is a standard angular momentum basis in ordinary three-dimensional space. Anyway, part of my point is there's two very different kinds of vector spaces on which the same mathematics applies. And the main emphasis today is going to be on yet a third kind of a vector space, which is namely the vector space of operators. So in any case, for now, let me just call it B to be rather general about the vector space. Now let's suppose we have a unitary representation of rotations that act on this, I'll make a little space here so I can write it out, that act on their vector space B, such that the operators reproduce the multiplication laws of rotations. Now, this vector space B may have an invariant subspace. I've explained to you what that means. Let's call S a vector subspace of our space V, and we can picture it here like this. If we're in three dimensions, let's say here's the subspace S like this, and here's the origin. And let me draw here the perpendicular space, which I'll call S per, which is orthogonal to the given subspace. Now, we say a subspace is invariant under the action of rotations if the rotation operators take any vector in the subspace and map them into another vector in the same subspace, like this. In other words, it's confined to the subspace itself. Now, one can show if you have an invariant subspace, one can show that the orthogonal subspace is also invariant, if these are unitary operators. And the result of this is that if you take a basis, which is an orthonormal basis in the subspace, plus another orthonormal basis in the orthogonal space, and in that basis, the matrices, which represent our rotation operators U of R, they have a block diagonal form. The dimension of these two spaces, the S and its orthogonal complement, don't have to be the same. So I'll kind of draw the block diagonal like this with a small block and a large block. But the point is that the off-diagonal blocks here are all zero if you have an invariant subspace, as I've described. As far as the diagonal blocks, they can contain matrices, which in general are not zero, so I'll just draw them as X's here. Now, this subspace S may itself possess an invariant subspace, a smaller space which is invariant. If it does, then we say the subspace S is reducible. If it does not possess a smaller invariant subspace, then we call it irreducible. Let's suppose that S is reducible. What that means is that we can do another change of basis inside here, you know, some new set of basis vectors, splitting S into smaller orthogonal subspaces. And then this lower block here, let's say the lower block corresponds to S and the upper one corresponds to S per, then this becomes block diagonalized with zeros in the off diagonal and then generally non-zero matrices on the diagonal like this. So every time you can take one of these spaces and any space which is reducible and break it into smaller invariant spaces, it corresponds to a successive block diagonalization of the rotation operators. This is important in quantum mechanics because when you diagonalize matrices, it's a lot easier to do with small matrices than it is with big ones. This is one of the advantages of this whole subject. In any case, what we can do then is to proceed breaking subspaces, reducible subspaces, into smaller ones, invariant subspaces, until all the subspaces we have are irreducible. And at that point, no more decomposition can be achieved. And the matrix then finally is represented by a bunch of blocks in the diagonal where each block corresponds to an invariant irreducible subspace. And thus, the invariant irreducible subspaces, in effect, form the building blocks out of which the representation U of R is made. All representations of the rotations on any vector space whatsoever ultimately can be put into the form
diagonal block diagonal matrices where the diagonal blocks are of standard form. They just correspond to the angular momentum that correspond to the given blocks.
Now, in the case of cut spaces, we spoke of the standard angular momentum basis, which just came from diagonalizing J squared and JZ and using raising and lowering operators. So if our vector space V, let's say, is a cut space E, I'll write it like this, then I can say what the invariant irreducible subspaces are in terms of this standard angular momentum basis. These subspaces are the, I'll call them E gamma J. They depend on the first two quantum numbers, but not on M. In fact, they're just the span of these basis vectors, gamma J M, in which M runs from over its range of minus J plus J. And the result is the dimension of these are the irreducible invariant subspaces is equal to 2J plus 1, like this. And so that's what happens when you do the block diagonalization. Now the irreducible invariant subspaces, each one has a dimension of 2J plus 1. There's a different J value for each block. All right. So this is how it works out in cat spaces. And this is the basic definition of irreducible invariant subspaces. Now, this is the beginning of a much more elaborate theory you can take other courses on. And I don't intend to go into this, of course, it's in group theory. I don't intend to go into this very deeply, but I do want to show you how this applies now in the case in which the vector space is a space of operators. Well, let's turn our attention to that. So the idea here is that we have a ket space, as usual, represents wave functions in our quantum mechanical system. But we also have operators that act on the ket space. So examples of this include like the Hamiltonian or L squared or LC if it's a hydrogen atom, the position XYZ coordinates of the electron, the momentum, and so on. There's a whole list of physical operators that we use. Now, the space of operators forms a vector space. If you form linear combinations of operators, you get a new operator. And so, and moreover, it's a space, it's a vector space like this. And moreover, it's a space that rotations act on. Because if A is an operator, we've seen that if you rotate it, it goes into the operator U of R times A times U of R dagger. This is the definition of the rotated operator that we talked about last time. And so, the space of operators can be broken up into invariant irreducible subspaces. And those subspaces of operators are called irreducible tensor operators, and they're one of the main objects that I want to talk about today. Before I get into that, though, let me just give you some examples of invariant subspaces of operators. We talked last time about a scalar operator we call K. A scalar operator is one that's invariant under all rotations, so that K is equal to U of R times K times U of R dagger, and this holds for all possible rotations. It's invariant under rotations. We also showed that this was equivalent to the statement that K commutes with all three components of the angular momentum. These are finite, infinitesimal versions of the same statement. Well, let's consider the space of operators. If you think of operators as a big vector space, it is. It's an infinite dimensional vector space. Let's consider the space of operators in which we multiply some specific k by a complex number a. If you think about this geometrically in the space of operators, it's like a line like this where the multiplying by k scales up and down. A is a complex number. And what it does is it gives you a one-dimensional subspace of operators. Multiples of Hamiltonian, for example. Well, since this equation is linear in K if I multiply by A on both sides, what you see is that any vector, as to say any operator in this space, is mapped into another operator in the same space by conjugation. In fact, it goes into itself, actually. And the result is that this one-dimensional space is invariant under rotations. The operator spans, the scalar operator spans a one-dimensional space, an invariant space, or space of operators that's invariant under rotations. K can be thought of as the basis operator, and then multiplying by K, A is your general operator in that space. Now, this space is automatically irreducible because, it being of dimension 1, you can't split it in any smaller spaces. All right. Now, let me give you another example of an invariant subspace operator. Let's take the example of a vector operator, of which we saw several examples in the last lecture. I'll remind you the definition of a vector operator is that if we rotate the vector operator, let me do this in index form, I think it'll be easier. U of R dagger sandwich around VI, the I component of the operator.
This is the sum on J of V sub J times RJI, the rotation matrix. So if we think about the three operators, which are the three components of the vector operator, Vx, Vy, and Vz, such as the components of momentum, for example, then what you see is that if think of these now as being three basis operators that span the three-dimensional space of operators. The general operator in this space would be a linear combination of these basis operators. That is to say, we have the form of Ax, Bx plus Ay, By plus Az, Bz, where the A, X, Y, and Z are just ordinary numbers. They're an expansion of a linear combination. We would normally write this as A dotted into B in this notation, where A is a vector of numbers and B is a vector of operators. That's how you normally write it. But this is the general form of an operator that lies in this three-dimensional space of operators spanned by these basis vectors or basis operators. Now, by the definition of the vector operator, however, you can see that if you transform, if you rotate any one of these basis operators, you get a linear combination of the same three basis operators. And the result is that this entire subspace of operators is invariant in the rotations. In fact, it is not only invariant, it's irreducible. It has no smaller invariant subspace. I won't prove that because it won't be important for us. But in fact, this is a second example of an irreducible subspace of operators. In addition to the scalars, which is one-dimensional space, this is a three-dimensional space. All right. What about a tensor operator? We talked about a tensor operator, Tij, last time. It's a tensor of operators. That means there are nine operators. And the transformation law is that if you conjugate by rotation, which is what we call a we take one of the components and we rotate by our definition of rotating operators. This gives us a transformation law that looks like this. It's a sum on K and L of the components TKL times RKI times RLJ, like this. And so what you see is that we have a nine-dimensional space of operators spanned by these components. And in fact, it is invariant in the rotations because you get a linear combination of the same operators if you rotate any component. Yes?
Is there a reason you switch from calling the inverse, you switch from UR dagger to UR inverse?
No, there's no reason for it. UR dagger. Those are unitary operators. All right. So this is indeed an invariant subspace. Now the question is it reducible or irreducible? Does it have any smaller invariant subspaces? Unlike the case of the scalar and the vector operators, the space of second-rank tensor operators actually is reducible. Here's an example of this. If we take the trace of the tensor, which is the sum on I of Tii, this, of course, is another operator. It's just the sum of the diagonal elements. And we conjugate this by rotations, write it like this. This is equal to summing on I on the right-hand side. This is the sum on K and L of TKL. And now all I need to do is just copy this, except I'll set I equals to J. So I get RKI times RLJ. But if we do this in the sum on I of these two R matrices, because of the orthogonality of the R matrices, this gives us a quantum result in K and L. And so the result is it becomes just a sum on K of T sub KK. As you see, it's just a trace of the tensor operator all over again. And so the trace of the tensor operator is invariant in the rotations. Therefore, it forms a one-dimensional, it's like it's a scalar. The trace of the tensor operator is a scalar by the definition of a scalar operator. And thus, the nine-dimensional space of second-rank tensor operators breaks up into a one-dimensional space, which is the trace, scalar, plus eight more dimensions. There's eight more dimensions to the tensor operator. Now, is this eight-dimensional space reducible or irreducible? The answer is that it is also reducible. It's reducible for this reason. If we take the anisymmetric part of the tensor operator, let me call it Tij minus Tji. It might be convenient to divide by two. That's sort of not important. The important thing is we take the anisymmetric part. Now, the anisymmetric part of a 3x3 matrix can always be associated with a 3 vector. It works like this. We get 0, 0, 0. If I call a vector, I don't know, let's call it A, and here we have the component, it's 1, 2, 3, so it's AC, then 1, 2, 1, 3 is minus AY, and then this is minus AZ, and this is AX, and this is minus AX. And I guess that doesn't, no, no, no,
have a y here, and minus ax here. In any case, it's possible to associate an anisymmetric matrix with a vector. And if you do this, what you'll find is, by conjugating this by u, I'll skip the calculation, but what you'll find is that this, the conjugating this anisymmetric tensor by the u's transforms it into another anisymmetric tensor. And therefore, the three independent components get mixed up amongst themselves. And what we have is a three-dimensional invariant subspace. And so this 8 breaks up into a three-dimensional invariant subspace, which in fact is irreducible. Plus, what's left over is 5 dimensions. And as far as the final 5 dimensions, those are spanned by operators which are, they can't be anisymmetric, because we took that part out already. So they have to be symmetric. But they can't have any trace either, because we took that all already in the scalar. And so a basis for the remaining five-dimensional space is the symmetric part, which I'll write this way. 1/2 Tij plus Tji minus something to make it traceless. And the something is this. It's 1/3 delta Ij times the trace of the tensor T, like this. Because if I take the trace of this, then the trace of delta ij is 3, which cancels the 3, and the trace of t cancels the trace of t and gets 0. So this is symmetric and traceless, and there's actually 5 independent components of that, which forms the basis of this final space. So what we get is a decomposition of the space of an invariant subspace of operators with nine basis operators into a 1 plus 3 plus 5 dimensional invariant in irreducible subspaces. This dimensionality count, not by accident, is the same as what you get in a Clebsch-Gordan calculation, in which you combine two angular momentum, 1, together. And what you get coming out, according to the rules, is you get 0 plus 1 plus 2. These are the allowed values of the total angular momentum, which corresponds to a dimensionality count of 3 times 3 for the 2 j equals 1s, equals to 1 plus 3 plus 5. Which equals 9, is two ways of decomposing 9. And this is not an accident either. This decomposition of this tensor is closely related to the Clebsch-Gordan decomposition of the product space of two j equals 1 angular momenta. Vector operators, in a sense, are j equals 1 objects, and these tensor operators like this are a mixture of 0, 1, and 2 objects. The most important symmetric traceless tensor, the right here, which is like a J equals 2 tensor, or J equals 2 operator, is the quadruple moment tensor. And this is important in nuclear physics, and I may say more about it later on in the lecture for this talk. I'll just come back to quadruple moment tensors. All right. So to briefly summarize, this is some examples of spaces of operators that are invariant under rotations and how they can be broken into irreducible spaces and so on. Yes?
Why does the symmetric one have to be traceless?
Because we already took out the trace, and so we're interested in the basis of the remaining five-dimensional space of operators. And it's symmetric because we already took out the anisymmetric part, which is at 3 up here. So what's left over is the symmetric and traceless. Actually, the quadruple moment tensor just turns out automatically to be symmetric and traceless. I mean, it's not an accident, but if you go through the calculation, it comes out that way. All right, so now what I'd like to do is to define, we've defined already vector scalars and vector and tensor operators. I'd now like to make a definition of a new class of operators, not so new actually, which are called irreducible tensor operators. So you'll recall that a vector operator really means a vector of operators. It's a collection of three that transform a certain way into rotations. So an irreducible tensor operator is the following. First of all, it's not just one operator. It's a collection of operators of 2k plus 1 operators. In fact, you might say irreducible tensor operator of order k, if you want to put it in, be a little more formal about it, is a collection of 2k plus 1 operators that we denote this way. We call it tkq. T stands for tensor. K is an index, where the q index ranges from minus k up to plus k. given you've only got a 2k plus 1 operators, you can see from the notation that k is like an angular momentum, like it's like a j value, and q is like a magnetic quantum number. It behaves that way in terms of the labeling of the operators. Okay, such that it has specified transformation properties under rotations. And the transformation properties, the question I'm going to put on the board that I've now covered up, but I'll open it up. We have the board in which I summarize the transformation properties of basis vectors, catch vectors under rotations, and also the spherical basis of ordinary three-dimensional space under rotations. The irreducible tensor operator has this property, that if I take a TKQ, one of the components of the irreducible tensor operator, and I rotate it by conjugating with rotations, that's how you rotate operators, what you get is the sum of Q prime of TKQ prime, that is for the same value of K, the different values of Q prime, with coefficients which are D matrices, TK, Q prime, Q of R. And then by comparing these three formulas, you can appreciate that an irreducible tensor operator, what's called an irreducible tensor operator, is a collection of operators, actually forms a standard angular momentum basis of operators, transforms under rotations exactly as a standard angular momentum basis transform in the case of other vector spaces upon which the rotations act. All right, so that's what it is. It's just the right-hand side, so it's just this rule for transforming basis vectors. But we use the rule for rotating operators over here instead of rotating vectors. So it takes two U's instead of one. All right. Now, let me give you some examples of this. In the first place, let's take the case k equals 0. If k equals 0, then q has only one value, 0. It goes from 0 to 0. So an irreducible tensor operator would be one such that u of r times t 0, 0, it has only one component, u of r dagger. By the definition, this is the sum of q prime of t 0 q prime times d 0 q prime 0 of r. However, q prime can only take on the value of 0. That's the only term there is in the sum. So this becomes T00 times D000 of R. Well, the rotation matrices for the case of J equals 0 are just 1 by 1 matrices containing 1. The component is just equal to 1. As matrices, these are all 1s, 1 by 1 matrices. That's because J equals 0s are invariant in the rotations, and so when you rotate them, it just multiplies by 1, which doesn't do anything at all. Those are S waves, if you're talking about wave functions. All right, so the result is this is equal to T00. And so what you see is that at K equals 0, irreducible tensor operator is the same as a scalar. It's something that's invariant in the rotations. So this applies to any scalar such as the Hamiltonian for isolated systems. All right, let's go on to the next example, which is K equals 1. In this case, we have two. Goes 0 and plus and minus 1. It turns out that a k equals 1 irreducible tensor operator can be created by taking any vector operator as we have defined it up to this point. Our definition used Cartesian coordinates. But if we go over to the spherical basis, then what we obtain is a T1Q. So here's what we'll do. I'll remind you that we called, if we dot this with the spherical basis vector e sub q. This is what we call b sub q. And I'll write this also in another notation as t1q to indicate that it, say, gives us the components of an irreducible tensor operator with k equals 1. It's a vector operator, but expressed in terms of the spherical basis. Now, to show that this really is such an irreducible tensor operator, let's do this. Let's take this u of r t1q u of r dagger, and let's calculate what it is. It's the same thing as u of r times e hat sub q dotted into our vector operator p times u of r dagger. The e hat sub q is just a vector of numbers, so you can take this out. What's left over is conjugating the vector operator. So this is equal to e hat sub q gotten into, I mean, just use the definition that from last lecture, what a vector how a vector operator transforms. So this is gotten into a R inverse applied to T. Then, however, we can shift the R inverse over to EQ if we turn it into an ordinary rotation, drop the inverse, got it into the vector P. And now, we know how the spherical basis vectors transform into rotations, if I can lift my board again. This is just they themselves form a standard angular momentum basis, so they transform into D matrices with J equals 1 in them. And so, this R sub Q, to continue writing this out down here, becomes the sum of Q prime of D hat Q prime times D1 Q prime Q of our rotation R. That's the first factor here. And so this whole thing is then dotted into our vector V. But the vector V only dots into this E hat Q here, so it is all this. And it becomes a sum on Q prime of V sub Q prime times a D1 Q prime Q of R. And the result is that if I replace the dq by t1q, you see the definition of a k equals 1 irreducible tensor operator is produced. So simple rule, to get a k equals 1 irreducible tensor operator, which is a collection of three operators, since k equals 1 gives you 3 q values, all you need to do is take any vector operator and just compute its components on the spectrum of the spherical basis. I'll remind you that when we were looking at matrix elements for the transitions, radiated transitions of hydrogen, where I've shown you some examples in last lecture, we had these matrix elements here, which were NLM with primes on them on the left, the transition operator in the middle, and then NLM on the right. And then what we did was we took the Cartesian components of the radius vector R and replaced them by the spherical components Q. And the result of that was, in effect, to replace the operator in the middle by the standard components of an irreducible tensor operator. So now what you've got is a standard angular momentum basis on the two sides. You're taking matrix elements with respect to that, and you've got an irreducible tensor operator in the middle. These are the forms of matrix elements which are very common everywhere in applications in quantum mechanics. And the Zwinger-Eckardt there, which maybe you'll get to today, concerns of matrix elements of precisely this type. This was an example of such a thing. All right. Now, this is the case of a k equals 1 irreducible tensor operator. Without going into details, let me say that if you take the quadruple moment operator, which is expressed, I spoke of it earlier in terms of Cartesian coordinates. I actually didn't write it down, but it's a Cartesian basis. If you go over to a spherical basis, then what you'll find is that it's a k equals 2 irreducible tensor operator, and the five components are the same as q running from 0 plus or minus 1 to plus or minus 2. The quadruple moment operator is important for the spectra of nuclei, and say more about that later in the course. All right. Now, I'm afraid I've kind of covered up with the actual definition. I didn't finish it here because finishing the definition is down here on this other board. Before I get into that, let me remind you that in the case of a scalar operator, we actually had two definitions. One was that it was invariant in the rotations, but we found that it's equivalent to saying that the scalar operator commutes with the angular momentum. This is in part two. Well, this scalar operator has one component. Likewise, when we talked about a vector operator and Cartesian components, we found the definition of the vector operator in terms of finite rotations, which I have not repeated here, is equivalent to what's in effect an infinitesimal version, which is a commutation relation with angular momenta. That's these relations here. I'll remind you that there's two different versions or two different ways of defining scalar and vector operators in the Cartesian components. Now, the same thing can be said for irreducible tensor operators, is that there is a finite version in terms of finite rotation, which is just this. And it just means that they form a standard angular momentum basis in operator space. However, there's also an infinitesimal version that comes from allowing the rotation here to be infinitesimal. And the infinitesimal version turns into, as you might expect, commutation relations. So I'll summarize the commutation relations over here, and then I'll prove them for you. So the point here now is to make an alternative or equivalent statement of the definition of an irreducible tensor operator in terms of commutation relations rather than the transformation properties under rotations. So here's what the transformation properties are. Is that first of all, if I take J to Z and I form the commutator with an irreducible tensor operator with indices k and q, what it does is it just brings out the factor of q times tk q. As you see, the q looks like a magnetic quantum number. The conjugating with jz is like letting a jz act on a cathode as a magnetic quantum number. It just brings that quantum number out. If you want it to be dimensionally right, I'll put in the h bar there. Likewise, if you have j plus or minus and you form the commutator with a TKQ, what you get is h bar times the usual square root, except expressed in terms of k's and q's instead of j's and m's. So it becomes k minus or plus q times k plus or minus q plus 1, famous square root. And then we have TK with a q that's been raised or lowered. So you raise or lower the components of an irreducible tensor operator by forming the commutator with the raising and lowering properties. And then finally, there's a third identity, which is this. It's the sum on I of a double commutator of Ji, commutator with Ji, with TKQ. These are the Cartesian components. This equals to H bar squared times K plus 1 times TKQ. And this is a statement that, in a sense, an irreducible tensor operator is an eigen operator of J squared with eigenvalue kk plus 1. This gives meaning to the angular minimum quantum number of the operator. All right, so these are the three infinitesimal versions, or commutator versions, that are equivalent to the single transformation law under rotations. Now, allow me to actually prove these. And I'll do that by starting with this definition. I'll have to cover it up, so just to preview, what I'm going to do is just replace these two U's by infinitesimal rotation. And likewise, this D matrix here is the matrix elements of a U. That's what a D matrix means. And write it this way, it's KQ prime U of R KQ. That's just what a D matrix is. I don't have to say what space these cats K and Q lie in. Can be any space that has the quantum numbers k and q, because the matrices are independent of the nature of the space. It's just convenient to write this as a matrix element in this way. So I'm going to then replace this u also by its infinitesimal version. So let me do that. So we will. We don't do that. So the definition of an irreducible tensor operator, if the rotation is infinitesimal, looks like this. Here's an infinitesimal rotation. I'll set h bar equals 1 to save writing. Here's the TKQ. Here's the inverse or dagger of the infinitesimal rotation. Just change the sign. This is an axis angle form. This should be the sum on q prime of TKQ. Times the infinitesimal TKQ prime, times the infinitesimal D matrix, which I'll write this way, is KQ prime, and then 1 minus I beta n hat dot into J for the rotation in the middle, KQ, like this. Now, if we expand this out on the left-hand side, what we get is TKQ for the 1 here and the 1 there. Then you get minus I theta, n hat dotted into J, commutator with TKQ, because here's an n hat dot J times TKQ, and then here's the other way around, opposite sides, through first order. And then on the right-hand side, through first order, we get, since there's the 1 here, just gives us Kronecker delta and QQ prime, which just gives us TKQ. And then the second term is with a plus, it's, let me write this way, it's minus I theta, and then it's the sum of Q prime of TKQ prime times the matrix element K Q prime n hat dotted into J and then K Q like this. So the TKQ's leading terms, of course, cancel, and so does the minus sign theta, like this. Now, in hat, it appears on both sides here as an arbitrary unit vector, so you can choose it to be x hat, y hat, or z hat, and thus you can just drop the n hat and you get a vector relation. Let me write that out. You then have this relation here as the j commutator of TKQ is equal to the sum of Q prime. TKQ prime, and then we've got the matrix element KQ prime, and then just J in the middle, J vector, and then KQ on the right, like this. Now, having done that, I can then dot both sides by any constant vector A. So let me do that, make this A dotted into J here, and A dotted into J there. Really, all I've done is just replace the n hat by an a, which is okay since this works for any n hat. So this is a basic commutation relation. Now let's take some special cases of this. Let's first of all take the case that a hat is equal to z hat. Excuse me, a vector is equal to z hat. A doesn't have to be a unit vector, but it could be. Let's let it be equal to z hat. In which case, we get the commutator of jz with tkq. Is equal to sum on Q prime of TKQ prime, and then this becomes the matrix elements of JZ. JZ acting on KQ just brings out a Q, and the rest of it is a Kronecker delta, so this becomes Q, and it's Kronecker delta QQ prime. And so the result of this is that it's Q times TKQ. There's your commutator with JZ. And the result is we get this commutator here. Right. Now, if I choose the vector A to be equal to, let's say, x hat plus iy hat, then this becomes a j plus. This becomes a j plus. And we get, without much trouble, in exactly the same way, we get the second commutator, plus and minus. And then, finally, letting A be equal to one of the unit vectors, but Cartesian unit vectors I was calling CI in yesterday's lecture, that just means X hat, Y hat, or Z hat. Then you get one of these commutators with JI. You need to repeat it. I won't go through the details in class. You need to repeat it because it's a double commutator. You find this resolution of the identity, it becomes a diagonal. And you get finally the final relationship, the final relation here. So in terms of these equations are equations involving operators which are completely analogous to what happens when you apply JZ, J plus and minus, and J squared to kets of a vector space, which is a ket space. You bring out exactly the same kinds of factors on the right-hand side. And that's just another way of saying that these TKQs form standard angular minimum basis, except in this case it's operators instead of vectors. Okay. Now, let me turn to the Wigner-Eckhardt theorem, one of the main results there. The Wigner-Eckhardt theorem, you get used quite a lot, of course, including next semester. It's especially useful for understanding radiative transitions in atoms. Wigner-Eckhardt theorem concerns matrix elements of irreducible tensor operators. We've got a TKQ sandwiched around basis vectors from the standard angular momentum basis on your ket space. So let's say it's we call in general language we call this gamma JM. I'll take primes on the left and unprime gamma JM on the right. So it's a general matrix element of an irreducible tensor operator with respect to standard angular momentum basis. Example that we saw this last time was the radiative transitions in hydrogen was this. where the RQ is the same thing as the T1Q, as a K equals 1 irreducible tensor operator. And you may recall we had a large number of matrix elements to evaluate because the magnetic quantum numbers, the M and M prime, as well as the Q, were variables there, giving us an example I mentioned last time, 45 different combinations. So it's the Wigner Eckhart theorem in particular addresses the dependence of this matrix element on the three magnetic quantum numbers. And what it says is that this thing is proportional to, and I'll leave space for that proportionality factor, it's proportional to a Clebsch-Gordan coefficient which contains these magnetic quantum numbers. In fact, the Clebsch-Gordan coefficient is this. It's J prime M prime scalar product with J, K, M, Q. This is the standard way of writing it, times the proportionality factor. And what the proportionality factor depends on is everything else except for the magnetic quantum numbers. So it depends on the M prime, J prime, it depends on the T, it depends on the K, but not on the M prime, Q, or M. And here's the standard way of writing that proportionality factor. It's sometimes called a reduced matrix element. It's written like an ordinary matrix element, except we omit the magnetic quantum numbers and we put double bars here. So here's the notation for it. It is gamma prime J prime, double bar, TK, double bar, gamma J, like this. And this is the Wigner-Eckhart theorem. Like this. Yes.
This inner product, J prime, M prime, J, K.
Yes.
I'm not sure about
that. Yeah, what space is that in? Is that what you mean?
Yeah.
Well, think of it this way. This is a Clebsch-Gordan coefficient. So the Clebsch-Gordan coefficient is what you get when you combine two spaces with fixed angular momenta. In this case, think of combining two spaces with angular momenta J and K.
So that's like.
So it could be in any space in which you started with, which you had two spaces with angular momenta J and K, and you combine them together.
So then M and Q are the two magnetic quantum numbers.
Yes, M and Q are the magnetic quantum numbers, exactly. Yes. So this is like that. I'm not sure I remember what general notation I used for Clebsch-Gordan coefficients, but it's like a total angular momentum. Sometimes you use capital letters for the total angular momentum, and then you write J1, J2, M1, M2 for the two constituents. This would be a common way of writing a Clebsch-Gordan coefficient. That's what this means. Okay. So notice here that if I label the angular momentum, the Clebsch-Gordan coefficient is 1, 2, and 3, just moving from left to right like this. And where they appear in the original matrix element is 1 on the left, and then 3 here for the K, and then 2 over here for the J. 3 and the 2 are swapped, in other words. This is only a convention, and someone could have defined it the other way around so they'd be in the same order. I don't like this convention because it makes the Wigner-Eckhart theorem harder to remember, and if you're worried about it, just look it up. I don't expect you to memorize it. But although I expect to understand the structure of it. But in any case, I think the reason that people do this is because in practice, these Ks are oftentimes small and the Js can be large. Because, for example, if you're doing dipole transitions, K is equal to 1, but the J is the angular momentum state in the atom, which could be anything, could be quite large. So they like to put it in this order, so you're adding a small K to a larger J. Anyway, I'm just guessing that's why they do it this way. The theorem would still be true if you swap these, but it's just giving you a different definition of the reduced matrix element. All right, so that's the Wigner-Eckhart theorem. Now let me tell you what it's good for. It's really good for two things. Probably the most commonly used thing is that it's good for selection rules. Because it tells you that the matrix element on the left-hand side vanishes if the Clebsch-Gordan coefficient vanishes. But we know that there are selection rules for the Clebsch-Gordan coefficient. So this whole thing becomes equal to zero unless the selection rules for the Clebsch-Gordan coefficient are satisfied. That is, first of all, the J prime angular momentum quantum number must be reachable by combining J plus K. So it must belong to the set of numbers that starts with the absolute value of J minus K, goes in integer steps, absolute value J minus K plus 1, et cetera, all the way up to the maximum of J plus K. Secondly, there's a selection rule on magnetic quantum numbers. The m prime on the left has to equal the sum of the m's on the other side. So we also have to have m prime is equal to m plus q. Now, if we apply this, to go back to our example, n prime, l prime, m prime, rq, which is a t1q, and then nlm for radiated transitions in hydrogen or alkali atoms, hydrogen-like atoms or alkali atoms would be the same. This is an electrostatic model. These selection rules would tell us, first of all, that this is equal to zero unless the final L prime, the angular momentum of the final state, excuse me, this is the initial state, that's the final state, the way we set it up. So the angular momentum of the initial state, L prime, must be equal to either L minus 1, L, or L plus 1. These are the only three possibilities. And there's another condition, which is that the magnetic quantum number in the initial state must be equal to the magnetic quantum number in the final state plus Q. Now, the physical meaning of this is the following. In radiative transitions, we're starting out with a definite state of the atom that has definite angular momentum. That's the L prime, M prime states here. So eigenvalues of L squared and LZ. After the transition has taken place, we have an atom in a lower state, but we also have a photon, which is traveling away. And what these rules are telling us is that the angular momentum of the photon is equal to 1. The spin of the photon is 1. Because combining 1, which is a spin, it's combining 1 spin of the photon, the angular momentum of the final atomic state, we can only use that to reach the angular momentum of the initial state if L prime lies in this range. Likewise, as far as the magnetic quantum number is concerned, this is conservation of the Z component of angular momentum in the emission of the photon. So it says that the total angular momentum Jz of the initial state must be equal to the Jz of the final state plus the Jz of the photon. That's what the Q is. It's the Jz of the photon. So the big record theorem is telling you about angular. These selection rules are telling you about angular momentum conservation in the emission and absorption of radiation. And lying behind this is a more fundamental rule, which is that the angular momentum of the combined system of the atom plus the electromagnetic field is conserved. This here we're thinking of an initial state in which there is no photon, so there is no angular momentum in the electromagnetic field initially. It's only atomic or matter angular momentum, but in the final state there's a mixture, and it has to follow these rules. All right, anyway, the selection rules, which is what this is probably the most common use of the big record theorem. It's very easy to use once you get used to it. Now, here's another application. Suppose, as I described in Monday's lecture, suppose we actually needed to compute all of these matrix elements for all possible combinations of M prime, Q, and M. A lot of those would be zero, but then a lot of them are not zero also. Well, the Wigner-Eckhart theorem allows you to do this it helps you to cut down the computational effort rather substantially. Here's what you do, is you look for a set of magnetic quantum numbers which satisfy the given conditions so that the matrix element is not, in particular the Clebsch-Gordan coefficient is not zero. Then what you do is you calculate this matrix element on the left-hand side. You just have to do it by whatever means you have to do. In the example we had last time, that would mean one radial integral plus one angular integral for some specific values of m, q, and m prime. Now, once you've got that then, so you have to do two messy integrals. But once you've got that then, you can then divide through by the Clebsch-Gordan coefficient and you can find the reduced matrix element. And once that is known, then all the other non-zero matrix elements can be determined by just looking up or calculating other Clebsch-Gordan coefficients. So it can be a tremendous labor-saving device also in calculations like this. Actually, in this example, we ended up using the 3YLM formula to get the final answer, or showing that it's proportional to the Clebsch-Gordan coefficient. The 3YLM formula is actually an example of the Wigner-Eckhart theorem. It looks like this. I'll remind you, it's just an angular integral. It's d omega, and you've got a YLM, one that's conjugated, and then you've got two YLMs, call them L1, M1, and L2, M2. And the formula itself is rather involved, but there's a leading factor here, and what's left over is a Clebsch-Gordan coefficient. It looks like this. It's LM, L1, L2, M1, M2. Like this.
well, this can be regarded as a matrix element that looks like this. Let's put LM on the left. Maybe we should regard, this is just a product, and put this in either order. Let's put the L2N2 in the middle. This is the operator, YL2N2. And then you've got an L1M1 on the right. This can be regarded as the matrix elements for functions on the sphere between two basis vectors of a standard angular minimum basis of an irreducible tensor operator. And so the 3YLM formula is an example of this, and moreover, it's one in which, by doing analytic calculations, we actually determine, I'm going to write it out here, we actually determine the reduced matrix element. You can get that from looking at the 3YLM formula. I won't repeat it, but it's in the notes. You can look that up and just pick it off, the coefficient. Okay, so those are the two primary applications of the Bingham-Eckhardt theorem. And we see quite a lot of those applications that we've received before. Before you go, I'd like to say that if it's all right with you, I'd like to have a makeup lecture on the, not next Tuesday, but the Tuesday after that. That'll be the Tuesday of Thanksgiving week. That means we'll have three lectures on Thanksgiving week on Monday, Tuesday, and Wednesday. And it kind of spreads out the effort, because otherwise I'd like to have four lectures in one week, and this way we'd have three lectures all the way to the end. So unless I hear a lot of objections.